Hello children, here we are back again to learn a new poem to appear on Sara's screen for class 10. It's from your first language English, written by Manmohan Singh. Okay, how about the poet Manmohan Singh? Okay, this poet is not the prime minister, ex-prime minister whom we had, Manmohan Singh. This poet is entirely different, Manmohan Singh. Their name is almost the same there. Okay, so saying about this poet, he is responsible for the creation of the Hari Cave Wildlife Sanctuary, the largest wetland in northern India. A poet, a bird lover, a nature observer and nature conservationist. Okay, he served as an IAS officer in the Indian Administrative Service. Okay, he is often called as a poetic voice of the birds. And next, his other works include short stories, and he soon graduated to writing veritable host of publications including the Statesman, the Tribune, the Ecologist and later Sanctuary Asia too. And you say about this poem to a pair of Sarasri, I told you that he is often called as a poetic voice of the birds. So he has written a beautiful poem to a pair of Sarasri. In this poem, the poet tries to describe the callousness of the bird killers, the hunters, and the sorrow of a Sara's crane which mourns the death of its mate. Okay, further going. So, what about the Sara's crane? So, which are these birds there? So, let us come to know about the Sara's crane. This Sara's crane is a large non-migratory crane. What a non-migratory? Doesn't migrate to other parts. Found in parts of the Indian subcontinent, and it's found in Southeast Asia and Australia. It's the tallest of the birds, okay, flying birds, and just see the height of it, so that it's 1.8, that is 5 feet and 11 inches, so you can imagine how tall they'll be. Okay, they are a conspicuous species of open wetlands in South Asia, seasonally flooded, okay, dipterocarp forest in South Asia, and eucalyptus dominated woodlands and grasslands in Australia. Okay, here, further coming to know about this birds, the Sara's crane is easily distinguished from other cranes in the region and definitely the tallest of the bird. When you look into your height there, it's 5 feet 11 inches, so definitely we can distinguish from other birds there. Okay, and one more thing how we can distinguish is the overall grey colour and the contrasting red head. You can see the picture of Sara's crane, what is on the screen there. Okay, wetland for roots, tubers, insects, crustaceans and small vertebrate prey. Okay, like other cranes, they form a long-lasting pair bonds, means they're loving to each other there, and they are known mainly because of their love for each other there, and maintain territories within which they perform territorial and courtship displays that include what? Loud trumpeting. Trumpets are making of loud sounds there, leaps and dance-like movements. In India, they are considered symbols of martial fidelity. Okay, believed to mate for life and pine the loss of their mates, even the point of starving to death. Means the if one bird is dead, the other bird, what does it do? It just cries out with pain and doesn't stay for a longer time. Okay, it also just moves away from the pace, means it sees its end. Okay, they are so much loving against each other there. So this is about the Sara's crane. When you come to the poem of Sara's crane, okay, a beautiful poem by Manmohan Singh. Okay, children, as we keep on going with the poem there, okay, I'll try to explain also about the poem. Now here, first let me read out the entire poem. Okay, the male was shot as he necked to pull the reluctant son out from the rim of horizon. She flew crying as he was picked up hands and jaws, and a proud neck was humbled to lie like dirty linen in a coarse washing bag. She circled the sky in moments of grace over his disgraceful end. The killers went away and she returned to the death scene with grief that inscribed its intensity in dots and pits like the Morse code of bird sorrow transmitted to the air. With a beak, she kissed a few feathers, picked the ones that wind had not taken away, and sat to hatch the blood-stained feathers into a toddling chick. A wave of the seas she had never seen came to her from far away and carried her to him. She went away beyond Hume's words, beyond the legends and fables of human love. Isn't a beautiful poem? It just depicts a love for the female bird towards a male bird. Okay, let me go as a paragraph wise there. The first thing, there are some words I've underlined children to highlight the meanings of it and some grammatical importance of that. So let's go. The male was shot as he necked to pull the reluctant son out from the rim of horizon. So here, the male bird. I've told you both are loving birds. The male bird, it just was shot, okay, by a hunter, okay, when the bird was flying high to pull the reluctant son out from the rim of the horizon. What is my reluctant there? The hesitating sun out from the edge of the horizon. So what happened? The bird was just flying very high. Imagine the bird, 5 feet 11 inches, were flying so high. It was just, you know, trying to just pull out the sun, okay, out of the rim, the edge of the horizon of the sun. She, okay, what happened? Immediately was shot dead. Okay, when he is shot dead, the male bird is shot dead, what happens naturally? The female bird is just watching there from down. So when this male bird was shot dead there, okay, the female bird feels very pity. Immediately, what does she do there? She flew crying as he was picked up hands and jaws. She is a female bird, okay, and she starts crying. Okay, and he was picked up. He is here, the male bird, was picked up hands and jaws. You know how the hunters handle the birds when they just have a shot at the birds there. Okay, and a proud neck was humbled to lie like dirty linen in a coarse washing bag. So when this bird was pulled out, hands and jaws, okay, his proud neck, which is flying so high, it's down now, okay, and was put down to lie like a dirty linen in a coarse washing bag. So what's the meaning of dirty linen? The dirty clothes putting into your rough washing bag. So like that, he was just pulled hands and jaws, and the female bird was just seeing all these things there. Okay, and I've highlighted a proud neck was humbled to lie like dirty linen. Okay, so here the grammatical thing that you come across is what figure of speech will have, children. It's a comparison between the neck and the dirty clothes. Okay, dirty linen. So here it is your simile. Okay, next, the bird, what is she, the female bird? She circled the sky. She goes up, she circles the sky in movements of grace over disgraceful end. So in the grace she is moving up, but there's a disgraceful end to the bird, the male bird. He is dead. Okay, so what happens here? The killers went away and she returned. The killers take the bird and they move away. Okay, and she, this female bird, comes there, okay, to the death scene. Imagine, the because they love so much, she can't be there without the male bird there. Okay, what happens here? The killers went away and she returned to the death scene with grief that inscribed means what? Wrote its intensity. Okay, in dots and pits. So what's the meaning of dots and pits there? Okay, here dots and pits means it is a short and long cries of the female bird. She has seen a male bird dead, isn't it? So these are the cries of that. She comes down. Okay, like the Morse code of the bird's sorrow. Morse code means what? A symbolic language. Okay, and do the actual meaning of it. It's invented by Samuel F.B. Morse, that used a combination of long and short sounds of flashes of light for sending messages. This you can see, some very close person, you know, it'll be human being or anyone. If they are dead, what happens there? You just give out a cry. Isn't it there? That cry, you know, will have a different combinations there. So here, the bird, the female bird, also gives its intensity of cry, okay, short and the long cries there, okay, which is transmitted to the air. With her beak, she kissed a few feathers. Okay, look at the agony and the pain she's undergoing. With her beak, she kissed a few feathers, picked the ones that wind had not taken away, and sad to hatch the blood-stained feathers, because the male bird was shot there, so there'll definitely be blood stains there. Okay, so here what happened? She sad to hatch on the blood-stained feathers like a toddling chick. So what's the meaning of chick? Have you seen the chick there? So it just walks there without any balancing there. Like a toddling chick, she sits on that blood-stained feathers, okay? And she wants that feathers to hatch like a chick. So what happens here? She has all the pain that she's undergoing, okay? Now here what happened? The next line. A wave of the seas. I told you these birds will never live without the other bird there. So what happens here then? A wave of the sea she had never seen came to her from far away. This is an imaginary thing, because she can't be along with the male bird, is not there. She can't live long also. So they definitely will pass away or die there. Okay, so what happens there? Here they're given an imaginary thing, like a wave of seas which had, what happened there, never seen, came to her from far away and carried her to him. Now you have to note this thing, children. A wave of the sea she had never seen, okay, came to her from far away. This you call it as euphism. What do you call it as? Euphism means here it is a mild or indirect word or expression which substitutes for one which consists of very harsh. So what's the harsh thing here? The female bird is not there. Okay, it's an imaginary thing, is what? She is being carried away. So the grammatical thing, we call it as euphemism. Okay, so what happens? She's carried away. Now she is no more. That's an imaginary thing then. She went away beyond Hume's words. So what do you mean by Hume's words? Okay, this is the meaning is they certainly pair for life. These two birds, I've told you that. And probably exhibit great reef for their male, keeping for weeks at times about the locality where their partner was killed and calling constantly. So imagine how what she would have done there. So she would have been there for weeks together, crying out loudly there. That's what I told you, that the short and the long cries are called as dots and pits. Okay, so what happens there? This is what they're saying. So here, it's actually a widowed bird to pine away and die is the meaning of this. The wave of seas comes there and takes her away. Okay, so what happens? She went away beyond Hume's words. So what are these? What is this Hume's words? Okay, Hume's words means one. Here, they are definitely a pair of birds, what he's saying. The pair of birds who can't live with one another there. Okay, so what happened? The bird exhibits a great grief, okay, for the male keeping, for the male keeping for weeks. And here what happens there? Once the bird is gone away, the male bird or the female bird, any one there, okay, the partner keeps on calling in pain and finally she moves away, he or she. So these are Hume's words taken from the Game Birds of India, Burma and Ceylon. Okay, now she went beyond Hume's words, beyond the legends and fables of human love. So here, what are legends? It is the stories from ancient time about people and events which may not be true. And what are fables? It's a short story that teaches a moral lesson, especially one with the animals, okay, as characters, like from Panchatantra tales and use of fables. I think you all would have gone through Panchatantra tales where the animals will speak with some moral values there. So what's the moral here? The moral is nothing here. It shows a love. Okay, for the each other, the birds there. They can't live without the other bird. So it's such a beautiful poem written by Manmohan Singh. Let us summarize it entirely, children. Okay, going for the next slide. So what happened? We'll just see this. So what happens? A complete summarization out of the poem there. Okay, once the Saraskin was flying high. Okay, pulling the red tent sun, I've told you, red tent means what? Sun was not willing to come, but she goes. You can see that beak of the bird there, the neck of the bird, and such a tallest bird there. Okay, it so happens, the hunter sees it, and he shoots at the male Saras crane. It was flying high in the sky. Its mate, the female Saras crane, flew about crying in sorrow and despair as the killers carried away the dead bird in a careless way. So what is this meaning of careless there? It is an inhuman way of what? Treating the bird. So that's called as what? Callousness. Okay, that's the meaning of callous here. Okay, yeah, further going. Agony of the bird, the pain of the bird, the female bird circled the sky, weeping and mourning the death of its mate. So what does she do there? So this is a pain that she is undergoing that I'm summarizing here then. So she returns the scene of the death where the hunter shoots at the bird then, and the bird is just falls down and they drag the bird there. I've told you in a very the majestic neck was just humbled by the hunter. Means what? The hunter did not treat it with care and concern. Okay, and imagine 5 feet bird just dragged away like that. Okay, so it was hunters pick up the lifeless body by hands and jaws and stuffs it like one stuffs what? Dirty clothes in a washing. But I thought dirty linen means the dirty clothes. So what happened? It shows the callousness of the hunters and she's also feeling very bad for them, but she doesn't look into that way. She comes in because she has lost her mate. She returned to the scene of the death and mourns so much that sorrow was telegraphed, okay, to the heaven. She kissed the feathers of her mate. This is what she's, how she's showing her mate being lost. She kissed the feathers of her mate which were lying there and sat on them to hatch her mate back to life as a toddling chick. Okay, she's sitting on the feathers, a bedstained feathers, thinking that she can bring back the life of a mate. Like what? Like a toddling chick. So toddling chick, I've told you there. She's just trying, I mean the chicks, you know, I've seen there, isn't it? There, how it walks and all there. Okay, so she wants to bring back the mate into a toddling chick. Okay. Now what happens for it? Again, the expression just carries on to the towards the hunters. So if you see the pictures, you know, you can just see how the hunters, how they drag the bird and all. Okay. So here, the callousness of the bird killers, how inhuman they were. What happens? The fact that those people who shot a bird, the hunters, okay, at a bird which was joyfully flying itself, okay, is an act of callousness. So never kill the birds, animals and all, because they also need a life where they have to enjoy, isn't it? So what happened? Okay, after killing also, what did they do? They dragged it in a very inhuman way. So the meaning of callousness is what? Inhuman way. So they just dragged the lifeless body of the crane by its arms and beaks and callously stuffed in a coarse bag. Okay, just like one stuffs the dirty clothes into a washing bag. They never considered the bird as a living creature. They considered as what? A dirty cloth. Okay, next. What happens here, children? The end of the female. I told you, it's your, the other grammatical thing I've told you what? How do you explain it? Euphemism. That's a grammatical thing there. So meaning of expressing that. So here the end of the female bird. What happened? The female bird gave up her life. Okay, that's imaginary. We say the bird, the sea of waves come and take her away. She went away to a place far away from the mortal world. The poet says that a heavenly seas come and sweeps her away to a land far away from the mortal realm. It means that the bird pines away for the dead mate and gives up her life. Okay, this is actually the life of the Saras cranes. So each one lives for the other. So here the poet uses the words wave of the seas to represent the end of the female bird. Yeah, like a tragedy there, and you can see some the bird picture just crying in dots and pits after losing her mate. Okay. Now coming to the glossary, hope you have understood the summary of the poem, children. There, it's very understandable. Okay. Now the meaning of legend is one stories from ancient India which may or which may not be true. Okay. Fables are short stories that teaches us moral life. I've told you Panchatantra stories where the animals are the main characters in this. Reluctant is unwilling. Here reluctant is which was very reluctant. The son was reluctant to come out. So next is callousness. I've told you already. It is a inhuman way of the hunters. How callously they treated the Saras crane. Coarse is rough. The homophone of course one go you can write as C-O-U-R-S-C. That also you can use it as a grammatical thing there. Okay. Finally we come to the end of the poem, the summary of the poem. Okay, yes children, now I hope you have understood this. Assignments will be sent through your mails there. Okay, and you have to answer all the questions and be ready with the summary. It's a very very important poem for your class 10th and for the board exam. Okay, thank you children for watching this and listening to the poem.